So it's about a workflow for identifying jobs with similar I/O behavior, thereby exploiting basically the time series analysis. So as Jay has said, this is work done with Eugen and with DKRZ. So I will give you a short introduction and motivation for this work, the approach we did, and the evaluation. Note that this work in that sense is not yet fully production ready, but still, and we need some community support, we think in long term, but I think it's nevertheless very interesting because we know that there is something missing. If you look at the data center staff that supports users, well, they optimize the programs and they typically proactively monitor inefficient usage. But if you are one member of this staff and you see an interesting job, for example, you see a very efficient or inefficient job, you by looking at the traces, performance analysis, or what have you, then you may wonder, okay, oh, this job now runs 8 hours. Is it worthwhile to optimize this job? Well, will it pay off if I optimize something? If I look at the libraries that are used by this job, will it benefit our users in general? So is it a good blueprint if I figure out this optimization strategy? And can it then be ported to other applications? Well, if I would know that, in order to know that, I would have to look at all the jobs that are executed on my cluster, but there are 100,000s to millions. So the question is, are there jobs that are similarly behaving than the job that I look at the moment? And if there are a lot of them, and they would use, for example, the same libraries, then I would probably say, well, maybe it's worthwhile to optimize, for instance, this library. So at DKRZ, there is a monitoring system that I don't go into too much detail that uses in the backend open TSDB time series database, and then it supported Grafana, and it takes, ingests periodic data from each node, different metrics gathered from PROC that are 9 aggregated metrics from Lustre systems. So DKRZ has 2 Lustre file systems, and then the Slurm pastes basically information about the job description into this database as well, such that you can in Grafana then link the activities on the nodes with the activities of the jobs, and those you can link with the users and so forth and so forth. So this runs all on the Mistral supercomputer, which is a 3000 node computer, 52 petabytes, more than 100 OSTs from Lustre. So I'd say it's sufficiently decent big system to make this kind of fun. Just as a side note here, we initially used some existing collectors here that capture data from PROC, but we figured they are too intrusive. They took too much CPU resources. That's why we wrote a very simple Python tool to extract those metrics and pump them directly into the open TSDB. Yeah, so again, it's the question, why are things bloated and resource heavy and cannot be geared to what we needed? And in a nutshell, we get in every 10 seconds, we get those 9 aggregated metrics. Yeah, we would have rather used something that exists if it wouldn't be so performance demanding, but well. Okay, how does this look like in the end? Here's a visualization for a specific job, and this job run on those 4 nodes. And then you can get those nice dashboards with the aggregated views of these different statistics. So we have here the 9 metrics. So we group them a little bit, like file creates, file deletes, these are individual operations, but then you have all metadata read operations grouped together and modifying metadata operations grouped together and other weird operations as well. And then we have the IO throughput, basically, statistics. Okay, so we have all this data. Now what we did as part of this work and this paper that you find in the incubator JHPS, and that will be published in a shorter version in LMCS2, we actually try to identify similar jobs looking at this time series of 10 seconds grouped intervals. What we did before, we spent quite some time over the years to look at clustering algorithms. But now, as part of this specific work that I introduced you, we were really interested to establish a workflow for supporting this investigation of jobs. Therefore, we had to look into meaningful distance measures. So what makes one time series of a job similar to another time series of a job? We are looking at particularly at 9 metrics. We must handle variable number of nodes and different lengths of jobs. And we looked at all these different options that we have, or at all a couple of them. And then we conducted a study of about 600,000 jobs, which is 6 months of data worth from DQLZ, but which has been recorded using this monitoring system that I've shown to you. And what we now did, we selected three jobs which have a totally different characteristics that represent the overall jobs in DQLZ very well. And then we tried to say, let's assume we are interested to figure out jobs similar to those three reference jobs. Similarly to this support staff member that has this job, one of these three reference jobs now at hand, and says, what are my jobs similar to those? Is this meaningful? Can we do anything? We did then basically compute the similarity of all these other 580,000 jobs to those three reference jobs. And we did then a qualitative and a quantitative analysis. And in the qualitative analysis, we basically looked at the top 100 most similar jobs manually, trying to see if they look similar in terms of behavior than our reference jobs. And yes, we explored different algorithms. So a question that we often or initially faced was, how can we handle variable number of nodes in runtime? So for the number of nodes, there's different ways of dealing with it. One way is that you just calculate statistics across the number of nodes, right? So you compress basically the n nodes into just one profile for all the nodes, or one time series for all the nodes. So by doing that, you can gain, for example, one timeline per job metric. Secondly, we segmented across the time dimension. So what we needed to do is, as we had 10-second interval data, it was very fine-grained, and it would have taken a lot of analysis time. And we were curious, is it sufficient to take 10-minute intervals and group it very coarse-grained? So we get basically, as a result, a time series of those segments. In the past, we, instead of just averaging them, we calculated additional statistics like quantile 75 or on a quantile 90 and so on, and use those. But we figured it's simply sufficient to take the average across these 10-minute intervals, and that works typically well. Now, what we needed to do as well as a challenge was to compare different metrics with different units and ranges. So for example, metadata, right, creates per second, how can you compare this with bytes per second? That's very difficult. We wanted to have a solution that works on different data centers too. So what we did is we converted the raw data, whatever you have, into categories. We have three categories. Zero is basically non-IO, one is high IO, and value 4 numerically means critical IO. And we did this based on the quantiles of the data that we observe in the data center. So here is, for instance, for, I think, the data written per job, we see the amount of data. Okay, so here we can see that the job, some jobs, we have a very few jobs that write more data than 1 terabyte, but most jobs write less data here than this amount here on the x-axis. So this is the basically the distribution function of this amount of data. And now what we did is we said, if this is less than 99% of what we see, then this is not IO critical. So 99% of the values that we ever observe, we consider them as non-IO. And that's actually justified because we looked at the numbers that we obtain, and this means typically something like 10 kilobytes a second, okay? If you have an application that does less than 10 kilobytes a second on a node, this is not IO crucial at all, right? Given that you can do a couple of gigabytes a second per node. I hope you agree. So we looked into these numbers and they made sense. And high IO was then the 99.9 quantile, and then everything else is basically critical IO. That's also good because as a support staff, I cannot afford to look at all the jobs. I can probably look at every 1,000 job. Yeah, so which is justified then by looking at jobs with that are higher than high IO, so critical IO jobs I can probably look at. Okay. So yeah, in terms of metadata, it was also meaningful. We saw that you have jobs that create or have less than one metadata operation per second, and that surely is not critical. All right, So we looked at different algorithms. We explored 6 algorithms that differ in the way they aggregate, the way they code. So that means how they quantize the data, if they quantize binary, or we grouped the values that we obtained also into 16 different states. We looked at different distance measures, Levenstein and Euclidean, for instance. What this led to was basically 5 time series based algorithms. So we have those that we also aggregate subsequent segments of zero activity. So we collapse actions where you have 0, 0, 0, and then you do some IO, for instance, into 0, 1. Yeah, so that's what this aggregation means. We have quantized coding with Levenstein distance, quantized with Euclidean distance. And to compare different jobs of different lengths, we use sliding window approach to find that position in a job where the smaller job basically fits best into the longer job. And the last one, phases algorithm, we try to extract phases of IO activity and compare them. So it doesn't matter in which order they necessarily appear. Lastly, we explored a non-time series algorithm called Kolmogorov-Smirnov, which allows you to compare basically the distribution functions of different jobs. Therefore, we actually used individual node data instead of averaging them. Okay, so now in terms of evaluation, let me quickly introduce you the reference jobs. So on the left, we see the job S. So that is, in fact, a single node job, a post-processing job that is quite typical at DKRZ. And this is the most typical use case that you have hundreds of thousands of them, basically. Okay, and we see the different metrics. Here on the y-axis, we see here 7 metrics. No, I think, I know, our 9 metrics show some activities. That's why they are shown. And we see for each segment, remember, a segment represents 10 minutes, we see the activity. And this is now quantized into 16 states. So basically, if the value is 15, it means that's the highest value that you can obtain. So here we see that basically beginning we have no write calls at all, and then at some point we see a very steady number of write calls issued. The number of write bytes, however, they are almost always the same. So that's very vertical. That means probably, right, that with less write calls you generate the same amount of write bytes, means more IO is done per call, right? So quite interesting. Similarly for read, we see a similar behavior and so on. But we see here some characteristics. So here the behavior changes here in between, and then we reach basically a second phase and we have a final phase over here. Okay, here's another job, a medium-sized job, 128 nodes for 8 hours. It just uses 3 metrics. All the other metrics are basically 0 after our quantization. And we see, you know, it goes here up, write calls, write bytes, metadata reads. Yeah, that's how it looks. Lastly, we have a job, a large job, that basically does only number crunching, and it needs to be initialized at the beginning. So it does a read at the beginning, but it has a lot of segments. It's 66-hour job, and we were just curious what happens, because these are exceptional jobs that only special users can start in GQLZ. Yeah, but this job here is reading, basically checkpointing data, and then it computes some stuff, and never doing any IO at all. So these are our reference jobs. And we can look at what, for example, this Kolmogorov-Smirnov algorithm would see. So we see here the histograms for these time series for the different metrics. For example, in file create, we have a phase, a segment in which we have a couple of those segments in which we have 0 for metadata other. We have a couple of segments where we have 5. And most of the segments that we see in file creates that are around 14. So that is basically this time series here, right? The histogram of the values that you see. So we see here we have 6 times, value 5. We have 14 a lot of times, and 1 time 0. And that's basically what we see here in this histogram, right? So it removes the time axis, but it gives you nevertheless an interesting profile. And you can see that we can distinguish already this from the job M histogram, because in job M, file create is always zero. Even for write bytes, the two profiles here, they look totally different. So that's what we can see. So it would be possible to distinguish those two jobs with Kolmogorov or Smirnov. Nevertheless, it won't be able to, of course, preserve anything of the order in which things take place. Okay. So now let's get started a little bit with the quantitative and qualitative analysis. When you look at the similarity for one job, now we look at job S, and we look at the different types of metrics that we have, we can create a graph that shows the similarity in terms of percent of the number of jobs. Of course, we have one job that is 100% identical for all these metrics, and that is this job itself, right? So that's our control. The job itself should be 100% identical to itself, which it is. That's why we always have at least one here. But for Kolmogorov-Smirnov, for instance, we find a couple of jobs, like 31 more, that are almost the same. And we can see here some characteristical behaviors. What as a user you can do now, well, a user as data center stuff, you could start from the jobs that are most similar and investigate them more thoroughly and have a look if they are actually the same kind of jobs than that you have as a reference job. Yeah, so we see those clusters. And well, typically what you would like to do is you would cut off at the end of such a cluster. So we would start here with the comparison, and then here you would say, yeah, I'm not going further beyond the similarity of 50% or whatever, because I looked into enough jobs. Okay, we also then did some analysis and correlated them with the names in the job pool. Names are very bad because names can be set by the user, but nevertheless, they provide an indication. What we see for job S, we have in our job pool of 600,000 jobs, 22,000 that are jobs that are called CMOR somewhat, and 367 that are control. And this job S is in fact one of the CMORized control jobs. Okay, so that's what we have. But we find that 30 to 40 of the most similar 100 jobs, in fact, that we find have also this name CMOR control in it. So that means we are very effective in finding out of the 600,000 jobs that are similar. Yeah, because we find the 40 out of 400 in this haystack of 600,000 jobs, which is difficult. Okay. Now we can look at the, of course, the different metrics that we have, like BX0, and look at the similarity. For example, a similarity for rank 4 that we have. So that is the fourth most similar job. It achieves a similarity of 81%, and this is what its profile looks like. Yeah. Compare this. Look at this here. We see, okay, at the beginning it's pretty much low, and then it goes up. And this, just mind you, that was our reference job. So it was zero at the beginning, goes up. Yeah, so we see, yeah, there is some, it seems to work rather okay. There was for a high similarity, it works. We also get jobs like this one with a similarity of 70%. Yeah, it also already starts to look worse, right? It does, at least from the time series, than this other job. With another metric, this Levenstein-based metric that tolerates insertions and deletions, right? So it's a little bit tolerant to changes inside the job. We get in rank 2 a similarity of 96%. So the job looks like this. We see that here are some ditches, but generally, yeah, we could probably say in terms of IO characteristics used, that job looks quite similar to the one we had before. Also this one and this one, yeah, they kind of are the same. And here then with a lower similarity, there are of course starting some differences to emerge. Now, when we look at job M, we see that these profiles look a little bit different. First of all, we get by far much less high number of similarity. Most jobs, they are very low, have a low similarity. The reason is, of course, like I said, we have less larger jobs at DKLZ. Most jobs are like one of up to four node jobs. That's why there is expected some kind of difference in terms of behavior. However, remember that I said that the number of nodes does not play a big role because we actually reduce this. We compress it away. So for all these five metrics here, at least, there shouldn't be a difference. But that means those large jobs, they have a different profile than the short jobs, which is actually good for us because it shows the method works. So for Kolmogorov-Smirnov, it's also slightly different because we concatenate the time series. So I'm not going into that. But yeah, this is how it looks like. And again, we can now compare the time series if we wanted. And you find examples in the paper, a lot of examples, in fact, in the JHBS paper, showing that it works. The binary versions, they don't work too well here. That's the nature of the simplified representation. Actually, we also were curious about the inclusivity and specificity of our most similar jobs. That mean, what we mean by that is, do we capture all the jobs that are interesting and that are really similar, or do we miss? Are we only capturing a single user, for example? And it would be clear if a single user runs 100 times the same job, well, probably you would get this cluster and you would say your method works well. But we really wanted to also capture applications from different users and different applications, right? That's the purpose of this method, is to find applications that look similar, have a similar behavior, but that are not doing exactly the same thing. That's the purpose. Okay, so what we have here is we also looked at a number of nodes. So are we capturing jobs of different node sizes? And the answer is yes, we capture a lot of different jobs. Here we see that, in fact, that our reference job is 128 nodes, which is over here. This is a logarithmic scale. So we have a lot of smaller jobs captured, which is by the nature of our matrix definition. In terms of runtime, we have also some inclusivity. So we are not only capturing the runtime for this job, but we include also smaller jobs. And Kolmogorov-Smirnov, which is not aware of the length of a job, of course, includes many more. And the phases algorithm just extracts the job phases that are I/O relevant, is also very much inclusive. Yeah, so that's basically by design. So our design does what it is intended to do. Now we can compare the different jobs to our reference. And basically, this rank 3 looks pretty much like our original job, also rank 2. But here we have two metrics that are also bigger than 0. That's why they are shown. We also capture now some jobs that have slightly different behavior. So they go up here significantly higher, but they still are marked with a high similarity because of the way this is calculated. Lastly, we have the job L, the large job. And here we get, of course, only very few jobs that have a high similarity. So most similarity is less than 25%. Kolmogorov-Smirnov here is not achieving any good results because of the profile is so flat. Most values are always 0. That it doesn't yield any good results. So we have more than 6,000 jobs actually that are more than 97% similar. And in terms of the phases algorithm, that also captures a lot of jobs that are similar because we have just one I/O phase. But generally speaking, here we find with this QNative and QLEF algorithm some jobs that have a sufficient similarity while they have a similar length. So from all this, yeah, what we concluded, and I would say it was really, this is a kind of couple of years effort that we investigated in looking in different metrics, comparing different algorithms and stuff, that then led first to this clustering, which we introduced, I think, last year. Eugen made a presentation, and this year we moved forward from them with this strategy to analyze similar jobs, we really think that it depends on the definition of similarity. What does it mean? What do we mean as an operator or at the data center staff when we say two jobs behave similar in terms of their IO behavior? We have to be very clear, and the definition defines what metrics we want to use. And then, only then, we can be sure that we get the right answer, jobs that look similar according to our definition. And it would be great, that's what we thought, that the community can come up with meaningful similarity metrics or definitions, because ultimately one research group is unable to do so. So I would say our little strategy showed, our survey showed that utilizing time series of system characteristics are suitable. I would say the algorithms work all well on job S, but for job N and job S, we generally preferred this Q-native and Q-left algorithm. That was our definition of similarity that worked well. The runtime, so all these algorithms can be run in a sufficiently short amount of time. So if you have, even if you have 600,000 jobs and you add a new job and you say, to which job is this similar, it goes rather quick. Okay, so it's nearly real time. And our expectation of similarity is important, and it must be defined by the needs of the user. Is it depending on the similar faces? Do we require the same job length? You know, how do we handle if you and we know this is crucial, because if you rerun the same application twice, you don't get the exact behavior, right? You get slightly different behavior, slightly different shifts and runtime. Yeah. So anyway, so the article here is the links to the articles, and looking forward to any discussion if there's anything.
Great. Thanks, Julian. I'll get us started out with some questions that I had. And you just made an assertion that you used the mean rather than the other metrics, and you thought that it looked okay. What did the differences between those two look like? Because that seems like just an arbitrary decision that I wanted it to be just using the mean instead.
I agree. So the question is what you obtain, right? So
right.
If we look at this, just this single time series here, right? We have to be sure how this has been produced. If this was a job that ran on 100 nodes, what has happened is you, for each time step here, we took the arithmetic mean of all these 100 nodes and put it here, right? So that characterizes a little bit what is the overall application doing at this time step. In average, it does each process or node executes 10 file creates or something, right? So that somehow characterizes the node. So now what we did before, so this is now the average. We instead of taking this number, we had this 10-second interval. So we had, if you go for 10 minutes, that's 600. So it's 60 data points you have per node. You can take all the data points for 100 nodes, 100 times 60. So you have then basically 6,000 data points. And from them, you can take statistics, right? You can say the median, for instance. Right, what is the median guy doing, or what is Q90 doing? And you can take multiple of those values and render them. The problem is, what does it mean, right? With that strategy, you could identify if, let's say, only 4 nodes of your 100 do a good job in IO, right? That is something you would get, but that's not what we wanted as a user, right? As a user, and we as a data center, we are really interested in, but that's what we figured, and we are really interested in what is the, you know, the typical node in this job doing, right? Because that's defining us. If we have this outlier where one node is doing a lot of IO and nobody else does it, we should capture this elsewhere, because it means we have no proper parallel IO, right? Something is broken in the application. So that's what we
saw. Or the IO stack.
Yeah, but I mean, I agree with you what you said as well. It is a little bit arbitrary decision, but we found this somehow more intuitive, right?
No, no, I think it's interesting. And the data simplification and the results show that it's actually pretty effective. It's just not an approach others have done, and because it's such a radical simplification. So I was just curious if you did not, what the comparison was and what the insight was, and that was a good description. So I had a couple of other questions here. We'll wait to see if anybody else has anything. The IO rate for the 99% over, is that over the entire run or is that just the burst? It looks like based off the graphs that the IO rate is actually an instant rather than over the entire application run.
The IO rate, which
so yeah, go back to the other slide you just had up.
Okay, this one.
Yeah, because here you commented that the non IO had like a 10 kilobyte per second. Is that a continuous over the entire run of the application?
What I've shown here is kind of the same graph that we generated under the hood, but it's not for the same way we calculated. It's actually per job, okay? So this is just indicate what has happened, right? So here we see that we say the same type of job, but what we did under the hood is we took these 10-second intervals, and we grouped them into these 10-minute intervals. And then we draw on the same kind of graph instead of per job, per 10-minute interval, right? So you have, and then you do the statistics, and then you can say, I want 99% of the 10-minute intervals that are non-IO, and that's this many. This is the value that you get. And that's then what I mean here in terms of one op per second. And that's per node, always. The metric per node, right? That's and 10 minutes computed. And again, right, I mean, we looked also initially, we wanted, there are so many ways to do this time series analysis. Yeah. And we submitted the same paper actually to supercomputing. And there were comments that, I mean, people don't understand that if you have 10-second intervals and 100,000, even for one job, how can you compare millions of jobs? It's not, it's not feasible and it's not reasonable. I mean, it's tricky.
Yeah. So we're just about out of time here. So I wanted to ask one last question. The trying to predict the time that IO is going to occur, that's been an often experimented on problem. I know back when I was in grad school, one of my co-students, Hassan Abbasi, he had done a project called Data Stager, where he was trying to predict when the IO phases were so that he could not overlap communication with computation, or so that he didn't interfere with the communication phases. So what approach are you using to try to do that prediction? Is the same just looking at what's happening historically and trying to go? And as you said, it does vary.
I mean, if you want to do that, of course, you need not only to capture the IO characteristics, but to capture like CPU load, which you can. I mean, we also could do that. There is one problem, I'd say, still with MPI implementations, that is that most of them do busy waiting. So you to detect when you are not doing meaningful computation, and when you do meaningful computation, and if that overlaps with IO, I'd say is tricky in current monitoring environments to do it with such a strategy. I mean, that's
okay.
And you would probably need, I mean, you would need to go to the smaller intervals, like 10 seconds or something, do some pre-computation, and then stage it up into some results that you can do for such a comparison.
Okay. All right. So thank you, Julian. So we're ready for our next speaker.